Nevada. You're watching March to March, presented by Principal. It's the penultimate game of the Mountain West Conference regular season. It's the UNLV Runnin' Rebels taking on a team that's firmly on the bubble, the Aggies of Utah State, as we look at the Mountain West Conference standings. Mountain West, 11-5 record for Utah State. Two games behind leaders San Diego State. UNLV is 6-10, but they started the season 10-0. Alex Sabario alongside Tim Doyle here at the Thomas and Mack Center here in Las Vegas. It's a very big game for Utah State. It's quad two game here for Utah State. They need to win this one. Stephen Ashworth, a big reason for Utah State's success because of his three-point shooting prowess.
Oh, clearly one of the best shooters in all of college basketball. And do not be fooled by baby-faced looks. This kid is an assassin on the floor, and he's going to have to do a little bit of everything in this spot for Utah State. And on the flip side, E.J. Harkless is old school. I mean, he can go out there and get you a bucket every which way. He's not necessarily a three-point shooter, but he is strong going to the basket. He has been outstanding down the stretch, averaged over 30 points a game in the month of February. UNLV is looking for some momentum going into conference tournament play. Utah State cannot have a slip-up. Alex Del Barrio, it's simple. Something's gonna give.
We got the starting lineups here for UNLV and Utah State. Shane Knowles come on as of late for UNLV. You see him in the starting lineup. Still no Luis Rodriguez in the starting lineup for the Rebels. That's been a big loss for them, not having his defensive prowess and ability to score as well as a third option.
You know, when you talk about UNLV, it is their defense. They lean on turning teams over at an extremely high rate. Utah State's one of the best offensive teams in the country. They shoot the three as well as anyone out there in college basketball. So you have contrasting styles in this matchup.
Utah State shoots a lot of threes. Taylor Funk, Stephen Ashworth, the big reason for that. They're a top five shooting team in the country as a team at 40%. So we take a look at your keys to the game, Tim Doyle. Obviously taking care of the basketball, number one there for Utah State.
Yeah, because UNLV turns you over at a rate of almost 20 per game. Competing on the glass, matching that physicality is going to be important for Utah State. As for UNLV, we talked about Harkless. Keep him going. Last out, UNLV scraped out a win against Air Force. They only made three threes. They're going to have to make seven plus, in my eyes, to win this game.
Brian Odom's the head coach in his second season here at Utah State after what a successful run he had at UMBC. He's got him on the bubble and potentially in the tournament, but right now they're on the next four out line for Utah State. But what a nice job he's done. And then Kevin Krueger, does he look familiar? That's because he's the son of Lon Krueger. Very similar facial features there between Kevin and Lon. Second season at UNLV coach, 35 wins already. Again, a 10-0 start this season. You and I saw them very early in the season, and they were as good as just about anyone else in the conference.
Yeah, they've had some injuries, and they've had to kind of move some guys around. But defensively, when healthy, as good as it gets in college basketball. As you take a look at Utah State, Jerry Palm has them clearly on that bubble, Alex.
Yeah, on the next four outline. This is a quad two game tonight. So Utah State, certainly, they're not going to move up a lot with a victory, but they certainly can't lose tonight in terms of a quad two game.
Well, it was a great matchup in the first one. It was a game that UNLV got zero to no, nothing from E.J. Harkless. He's going to have to be much more effective in this game.
A lot of foul trouble there for Harkless in that game. Only had one basket, 2 points. It's his lowest scoring output of the season. They expect to have him and be a very different game. Utah State in the blue wins the tip, and they've got the basketball here first. What do you want to see from both of these teams right off the bat?
Yeah, I think for Utah State, I talked about it. They just got to get into their offense. When they are flowing offensively, they are a pleasure to watch. As for UNLV, yeah, their defensive pressure is almost impossible to simulate in practice.
Pull up there from Shulga. Lost his defender, pulls up from the elbow and knocks down the first jumper of the game. Max Shulga from Ukraine. Gets things started. Here for the Rebels. That was Harkless with the basketball up top. Now it's to Keyshawn Gilbert, the sophomore, who's had to do a lot for this team this year, growing up quickly in that role. Missed from three. That ball tapped out of place. Last touch, Utah State. They weren't ready for it. So take a look at the series history between these two teams. 48th all-time meeting. UNLV has dominated this series, but Utah State has won four in a row, including the matchup in Logan earlier this year. But look at that, 19-3 all-time here at the Thomas and Mack. UNLV over Utah State.
That first matchup, Utah State turned the ball over 21 times and still managed to win.
Here's Harkless with a pull up from the left of the circle off the mark, and it's Taylor Funk with the rebound here for Utah State.
Utah State has not one, not two, but five different players average in double figures. So watch that ball move side to side. That's when they're most effective offensively.
Get it to Ashworth coming off the screen. He thought about the three, takes it baseline. He's not afraid to drive it and kick. Bairstow in the left corner for three, off the mark. The rebound taken there by UNLV. Mwaka now ahead to Gilbert. Sophomore from St. Louis, working his way inside, ran out of real estate and back out to Webster. This is Harkless to the rim, strong take off the window and in, ties the game at two.
We talked the shoot around today and I gave him a compliment. He's old school. I said, don't take that the wrong way, because he scores two-point shots and he makes hard ones, and he is a relentless driver.
What a three-point range that Ashworth has missed there. He's gonna try again, second effort, off the mark that time. They cannot let Ashworth get going. Here's UNLV on the break. Gilbert taking it to the rim, trying to draw some contact, no call, able to finish, way off balance on the shot, able to get it to go. Rebels up two. One thing that's going to work to the Rebels' favor is they can keep the energy going in this building. It is senior night. It's the final home game of the season. As we get a whistle here, and it's going to be against the Rebels.
At last out, I'll say it, they got lucky to beat Air Force. They won that game 54-53. And now you come into this game against Utah State almost with new life. There's new energy. March is finally here. John Rothstein, we sleep in May at CBS Sports. And they have come out and they have played with a fire in their belly to start this game.
Ashworth, little runner, got that to go. Known for the three-point shooting, but he'll drive it too. Webster back to Harkless. He'll take the three. Got it, rattles it home. To think Harkless was thinking about the last time these two teams met when he only had 2 points.
Yeah, he only shoots 26% from three, but he shot that one with confidence. That's going to be trouble for Utah State. There he is defensively.
Utah State turns it over here. UNLV up by three.
And you have to respect Ashworth's shooting. And there he takes advantage of it with the drive into the lane. You see the balance right now. Dan Aiken comes off the bench. He's had six double-doubles this year.
One of 12 teams in the country with five players averaging over 10 a game. You see the offensive prowess from this Utah State team. And usually Ashworth's going to get his. Funk is usually going to be involved, but it's always someone else, depending on the flow of the game, who becomes that third option for this Aggies team. That's why they're so dangerous. And if they get in the tournament, they're going to be very dangerous in that opening round.
Yeah, but so far, the pressure of UNLV has bothered them.
Harkless, corner three. Again, you mentioned not the best three-point shooter. That was kind of a heat check after a rattle that first one in. Bairstow. Jump pass out to Ashworth. Thought about it, hesitated a bit, had Harkless on it. Oh, lost Harkless. Ashworth with a nice little dish off there. And a little runner got that one to go. Trevin Dorius with the finish.
Dorius was really good in the first meeting, where he scored 10 points in 16 minutes.
Nice finish there. Walker. Shulga with the pull-up, rattles that one in, and now the pace of this game has picked up.
Shulga's last four games getting almost 17 a game. His offense has really picked up down the stretch as Utah State comes into this game on a three-game winning streak.
One-point game here in Vegas. Rodriguez back in. He's missed the last couple of games. Missed his first opportunity there. Can tell they were trying to get him a shot early.
He got a great look. He was open, and he was the first one in the gym today at shoot around, and
That's a shot he can clearly make.
Bairstow with a runner. Got that one to go. Beautiful shot there from Sean Bairstow, the senior from Brisbane, Australia. Certainly a lot of international flavor on this Utah State team.
Well, there's good flow of pace to this game right now. Both teams are in a nice rhythm offensively.
Coming off the screen, this is Gilbert trying to throw it up there. He's missing a tap out of play, trying to save it there with Rodriguez. And it's going to be Aggie ball. We step aside.
Utah State, every single game is important down the stretch here as our Jerry Palm has them clearly on that bubble. Stephen Ashford does it with the three here. He does it with the dime. You're watching college basketball. March to March presented by Principal.
College basketball on CBS Sports Network is sponsored by Principal, helping you plan, protect, invest, and retire. By Jeep, there's only one. And by AT&T 5G, fast, reliable, secure.
Back in Las Vegas, Utah State reclaimed the lead at 10-9 over UNLV, a quad two game. Utah State needs to continue to build their resume. Jerry Palm has them in the last four outs. Stephen Ashworth, huge numbers for him this year. Fifth in the country in three-point field goal percentage.
Yeah, and he was talking to me about his workout in the postseason. It used to be 300 made shots, and it's become so maniacal that now it's 21 out of 25 in each spot, but if he misses two in a row, he goes back to zero. It was almost like Rain Man-esque of how he gets after it in the offseason. That's why he is one of the best shooters in college basketball.
How many hours in the gym would it take you to make 300 shots?
We would still be shooting.
Here's Bairstow. Ashworth nearly slipped and fell. Seven on the shot clock. Working baseline. Good ball movement. Funk in the corner. Miss. Offensive rebound. And a two-handed flush. Dan Akin with the slam. Leading rebounder for Utah State, fifth in the Mountain West in that department. Big offensive rebound and a big flush. Jackie Johnson, three-point attempt on the wing from Webster, misses, offensive rebound. Quickly back out to Jordan McCabe, now it's Webster again, tries again for three, in and out.
Both shots were good misses though, right on the line, just in and out.
Funk. Kind of struggled with his shot as of late, struggling to hang on to the basketball there. As we get two hands on the ball, a jump ball is going to send it back to UNLV.
And what a luxury that Ryan Odom has, that he could go to the bench and bring in a veteran who's had six double-doubles on the year, just plays with amazing energy there. Now this is big boy basketball, this is March. Yeah, even though you box out, you got to find where that ball is. Utah State's doing a nice job of matching that physicality of UNLV at the start.
Dan Akin, a graduate transfer from London, England. He was with Coach Odom at UMBC, was a part of that team that beat Virginia, that first ever 16 seed to beat a one. And here he is with Utah State contributing big minutes for them down the straight stretch, trying to get them back to the NCAA tournament, the Aggies. Working inside, Keyshawn Hall working strong, gets it to go, count the basket on the foul. He had a season-high 19 points, the freshman did, the last time these two teams met back in Utah.
And he only played 25 minutes in that game. He's got a really diverse skill set, but this is basically mouse in the house, and he took it one-on-one and scored on one of the better defenders in the Mountain West.
We saw them in the MTE and San Juan Capistrano. We didn't even see him in the lineup. It was a very short bench for Kevin Kruger at the time, and he's worked his way in getting some of these underclassmen some more minutes. Some of it's been by necessity because of injuries, but they're growing up quick here at UNLV.
I think the biggest thing for him is changing his body. He's got great length, but now he's gonna put a little more muscle on to play on the inside, but he can do a lot of different things offensively.
Bairstow works his way to the block. Look at him finesse his way to the block and misses the shot, hangs onto the net there. Comes up empty, here come the Rebels. Jordan McCabe. in the lineup now for UNLV. This is Johnson and Gilbert. Now it's Johnson, the southpaw, launches the three, buries it. UNLV had started 1-for-6 from downtown. That's their second three. And they're up by 3, 15-12. Ashworth launches, got it. You know he's going to get going at some point.
I talked to him before the game. I said, who do you like watching? He said, Steph. I said, oh, he goes, Steph Curry. I said, I know who Steph is. I go, do I look that old that you have to say his both names?
Who would have been the other Steph? Rodriguez. Fancy dribbling up top, misses short. Offensive rebound there. Second effort, no, there for Keyshawn Hall. Pass ahead, they were looking for Bairstow, and Doyle's gonna have to make a play in the basketball.
Hey, give me a jersey for crying out loud. I see the ball coming this way, I wanna dive after it. It's March, tournament time's around the corner, and Stephen Ashworth is trying to get this Aggie squad into the big dance. You give him any space, he will make you pay. Stay up late, Mountain West style.
Back in Las Vegas, it is March, folks. We're tied at 15 in the penultimate game of the Mountain West Conference regular season. And we pulled Tim Doyle away from the roulette wheel to join us for this game here tonight. Alex Abario, Tim Doyle, glad to have you with us here. And Timmy, a huge game for Utah State. They're right now outside, if you ask Jerry Palm and his bracketology. They're in the next four out. Big game for them tonight because it's a quad two. They're not going to move up if they win, but they certainly can't lose.
No, and it's unfortunate because the Mountain West this year is so deep and so diverse. A team like UNLV has lost three games in conference by 2 points. You know, you turn around those three games, all of a sudden they are right in the hunt right now. The big thing is going to hurt them, right? 0-4 against quad one teams. Ryan Odom's did a great job here of getting all these guys to buy in. They play a really fun brand of basketball, but it's a contrasting style type of game. And so far, they have matched UNLV's intensity and physicality.
I meant to tell you, though, you need to stop putting chips on green. This is not, it's not going to hit.
That was my number, by the way, 0-0.
Jordan McCabe with the basketball here for the Rebels. Down low, reverse layup attempt there from Noel, off the mark. Utah State with a rebound.
Now, Funk has been quiet in this game. Last game these two teams played, he had 20 in the first half.
Funk's a guy that can certainly fill it, but he'll go on stretches, for the lack of a better way of putting it, where it goes into a Funk. He's on one now as Shulga misses there. Bairstow thought about it. Well, got a fresh 20 here to work with. Atkins setting the screen there for Shulga. We're going to whistle for an offensive foul. It's going to be against Akin. That's his second.
Two fouls in college basketball. That means bench time for any player in the first half.
That's five turnovers now for Utah State.
Yeah, and at that rate, that means they return the ball over 20 times. So first matchup, 21 times. That's not going to be good enough in my eyes on the road to win this game for Ryan Odom's crew.
A steal. McCabe telegraphed that pass in transition. RJ Idlerock muscles his way through and with some strength able to get that one to go. Another player from London, played at UMBC with Coach Odom. No, misses, gets the rebound with the kick out. Hall misses. Starting to cool off from three. They're now 2-of-8 from downtown. Here's Funk. They were on him early. Ashworth, crossover, nice move. Gets inside and able to float it and put it in. Gets the friendly bounce.
Yeah, he's amazing at taking what the defense gives you and exploiting it and getting to his spot. And then if there's help, making the right basketball play for his teammate.
Idlerock commits the foul there, another one against Utah State.
He
here's the steal for Idle Rock. He had 4 points in the first matchup. That was just great physicality. And then watch how Ashworth slithers through the defense. You don't step up. A little teardrop. Last out against Wyoming. 19 points and 7 rebounds.
McCabe coming off the screen, misses off the heel.
They list him at 6'1". That's kind of Fletch-esque, like 6'4 with the afro, 6'8". I think he's a little closer to 5'11".
Hamoda floats one up, looking for the alley-oop. Just could not finish. Could Dorius. The Aggies have a fresh 20. Ashworth. Work inside, try to pass it off, and there's, again, active hands for UNLV, another turnover, number 6.
Yeah, I think this is a play where Harkless has to make something happen for himself right now. He hasn't touched the ball in a while.
Harkless drives out to McCabe, thought about it, one dribble, lost his defender. Now back out. A little teardrop shot one-handed by Noel, off the mark. Here's another takeaway. Harkless, reverse layup. Thought he should have just taken it right side, ain't Tim?
Yeah, that's a layup he makes 99 out of 100. That is not a difficult shot, and he has to convert that. Once again, another turnover. This is starting to become a little worrisome, and Hamoda, it basically let him go, but that's an easy layup for, you know, a big-time Division I player. And that's one that normally he puts in.
7 turnovers now, though, for Utah State. Something that we'll continue to keep an eye on. And, you know, you go back to shoot-around, Timmy. Coach Odom was kind of on his guys at shoot-around about focus for this game. And a bounce pass. Dorius inside, able to finish this time.
Yeah, the more impressive thing there was Dorius's catch. That is not easy for a 7-1 guy to gather himself. Excellent hands.
The lead is 6 now for Utah State as UNLV has cooled off. They haven't scored in nearly 4 minutes.
This is what Utah State does. They share the wealth. They are on a 9-0 run right now. It seems like it's a different player every single time making a play. This time, Dorius with the catch and the finish. You're watching March to March presented by Rentable.
Nine nothing run for the Aggies of Utah State has them up 21-15 on the Rebels of UNLV. Next Thursday at 3 Eastern, get ready for some Mountain West tournament action here from Vegas as the men's quarterfinals tip off right here from the Thomas and Mack Center. Find out who will be one step closer to the big dance here on CBS Sports Network as we look at the bracket, what it would look like if the tournament started today for San Diego State right up at the top. As the one seed, Utah State would currently be matched up with San Jose State, who has been quite the surprise this season in the Mountain West. Tim Miles doing a tremendous job there. And you see Boise and Nevada. Nevada just went into Wyoming and fell to the team that's currently seeded 11th. Shows you how deep this conference is right now.
Well said. This is a conference that is completely up in the air. Air Force and Joe Scott, they are going to be a top 25 team within the next 12 months. I think that they are grooming something really special up there in Colorado Springs.
Make it a 12-0 run. Shulga hits from downtown. It's 24-15 now, Utah State. They seem to have found their offense.
Now, if you're UNLV, you need Harkless to stop the bleeding.
Harkless pull up from 15. That short range you were talking about. Missed there. And back come the Aggies. And this is what they do. They can score in big bunches. Bairstow on the take with the floater underneath for Dorius. Fakes that time. Then we get a block. Ashworth gets it back. He pulls up from 12. Got it. Doesn't matter where Steven Ashworth is on the floor. He's an elite shooter. Rodriguez with the toss-up, looking for the alley that time, and we get a foul here. Waka will go to the free throw line. It's going to be on Dorius.
Talked about last game, Steven Ashworth had 9 rebounds. Folks, he's 5'11", maybe 6 foot. He lists 6'1", which I appreciate. Everyone should lie about their height. but he just always has a nose for the basketball, and he finds it there. He's off to a great start. He has set the tone on the road, as we've talked so much about. Can't lose this game. Got to be in that hunt to stay on that bubble.
That ends a string of 1 for 9 from the field here for UNLV as Rodriguez, who's missed some time, 5 games due to injury this year. He's missed the last 3 and then missed 2 others in January. And, you know, he's a role player for them, but he's a big part of who they are as an identity.
Oh, absolutely. His physicality, his defense.
3-pointer and a foul here. It's going to be against Jordan McCabe. 3 free throws coming up here for Utah State. What'd you see here, Timmy?
Yeah, Shoga had made one before, so when you're late to recover, you get out on a shooter, but you're out of control. And McCabe should know better because that's what he is. He's a shooter. He was great in the first matchup against Utah State. He really kept UNLV in that game, him along with Keyshawn Hall. McCabe had 17 points. He banged down 5 threes.
Shulga, the junior from Ukraine. A big game against San Diego earlier this year. You take a look at what Shulga's done so far today. He's already got 8.
Well, he has 4 double-doubles on the year. So at 6'4", he's one of those guys that does a little bit of everything. But that's Ryan Odom's spot, right? Everyone's able to score. Everyone can pass. They move the basketball. And when he's making shots from deep, he's a really tough guard.
Misses the 3rd free throw attempt. Offensive rebound. Now Shulga gets it back. Got it for 3. And Max Shulga on fire. He's already in double figures. He's got 12. His 2nd 3 of the game right there. Now Utah State building some separation. Harkless working inside. Trying to draw the contact. That was a tough shot there from Harkless. Stops the bleeding a bit. They were 1 for their last 9 from the field before that make. Ashworth launches. That looked good coming off his hand, but he misses it long. Here come the Rebels.
This is an important basket for UNLV to get back in this game.
Harkless with the toss up again, looking for the alley-oop. And again, it's knocked out of play. It'll stay with the Rebels. Looking for Murwaka there with the finish.
Hey, Utah State is shooting over 70% from 2-point range. So when they have gotten inside the arc, because that's what you want to do. You want to chase them off the 3-point line. One of the best 3-point shooting teams in the country. And they have taken advantage of that.
Harkless quickly into the freshman hall. Finds some room. No, call for the offensive foul.
Yeah, I'd be curious to see if the defender is inside that circle. This is a good basketball play that I think the referees got this one wrong. I think they're going to call player control. I think I know what they meant, but I'm not in love with that call.
Ashworth messes it to the right. Offensive rebound, Dorius. Ashworth floats it up. Dorius catches, misses. Hall with the rebound. Boy, Hall is active, isn't he?
Oh, absolutely.
Here's McCabe, left open for 3. Count. Jordan McCabe from downtown, the 5th-year senior. He was a big part of what they did last year. They didn't use him much early, but come the conference season, they really relied on his leadership and ability more. Offensive foul, Utah State's going back to UNLV, another turnover, number 8.
You know, I gave you an exact number. I said for UNLV to win this game, they have to make 7+ threes. Last out against Air Force, they were 3 of 20 from 3. So far, they've already made 3 threes. And the way the game is played now, you have to have that ability to spread the floor. At least keep the defense on us, or else it's going to be almost impossible for Rodriguez and Harkless to drive when shooters aren't capable of making shots.
You know, this there from UNLV. Utah State up by nine. Ashworth, corner three, got it. Stephen Ashworth from downtown. Now he's got 12. That's his second three. Started one for five. Harkless takes the three. He got it. That was pretty. Nine-point game again. Aggies on top. Quad two game tonight. Big for Utah State's potential tournament resume. Driving to the rim and drawing the foul there is Akin.
UNLV trying to get a signature win at home. Build some momentum going into the conference tournament. EJ Harkless, he's doing all he can.
Back in Vegas, Utah State with a 34-25 lead over the Rebels of UNLV. Now time for Worth a Watch, brought to you by Principal. Take a look at Stephen Ashworth and what he's done tonight.
Yeah, just kind of that old school type of point guard. What an amazing shooter. I know that he loves Steph Curry, but he has a little Steve Nash in his game because he plays the angles so well. And he takes with the defense, gives you... Talk to Ryan Odom because we wanted a comparison.
Right.
What did Ryan Odom say?
He said he reminds me of me when I played. Now he did say I was D3 guy, so it's like it's not the same thing. But in terms of style, he's like that's because he's not a traditional point guard. He's a shooter. He's looking to score, but has the ability to make plays, pass the ball, drive in and kick. All those types of skills that Steve Nash had.
What I found interesting with Ryan Odom, when we asked him point blank, do you talk about your squad being on the bubble? And we were both surprised that the answer he gave us.
You and I have called games together for 4 years, Tim. I can't remember a time, especially late in the year, we've talked to a coach of a team that's on the bubble. Do you talk about tournament resume? Then I'll say no. And Coach Odom, who again came from a very different situation, came from a team of the American East and UMBC where you got to win the league, you got to win that tournament if you want to make the NCAA tournament. Here, you can have a tournament resume to get in. He's like, I want the guys to know it from us and not from, with all due respect to Jerry, from the Jerry Palms or Twitter. We want them to hear what their potential can be from us on the coaching staff.
I love that transparency there from Coach Odom. It was refreshing to hear an honest answer because, no doubt about it, it's the elephant in the locker room.
Something you can't hide from. That information is out there as they work it into Akin.
But I also think you have to have a mature team. And
yes.
That's what he has.
He's got a very old team.
Correct.
25-year-olds on this team. I think they're the fifth oldest team in all of college basketball by the numbers. That was the numbers from earlier in the year. But
I think if it's a younger team, you kind of go with that next game mentality. But with Ryan Odom, he's like, let's be honest. Let's talk about it.
Second season here at Utah State. And you know, very interesting hire for Utah State to go and get a UMBC coach as their next head coach. It's one of those where a search comes in and finds a guy, because Craig Smith was the coach here before, did a nice job, moved on to Utah. No connections to Utah State whatsoever. And here he is taking over a program that's right in the thick of things in the Mountain West every year.
Yeah, he had a very strong wake up to his team at shootaround today. There might have been some other words added to that because he thought his team was lacking concentration today, and they've come out and they've looked really sharp on the offensive end.
It's an 11-point lead here for the Aggies.
And this is where UNLV gets in trouble, a lot of standing around on offense.
Harkless, strong drive to the hoop. And he gets a lot of contact. He's not getting any calls right now. That ball's tapped out of play. Harkless has really made some strong moves to the basket, and he's starting to show some frustration here. He has his palms down looking at the officials saying, what do I got to do to get a call? As Ashworth drives it in, he gets the call, and they say no basket. Foul was on the floor up near the foul line. So it'll be Utah State ball. Coming up next, it's AT&T 5G at the half. We'll send you back to our New York studios. Adam Zucker, your buddy Wally Zerbiak in studio today. Renee Montgomery, Gary Parrish. For the latest around college basketball, AT&T 5G at the half is coming your way next.
I got a chance to work out with Wally Zerbiak, who was an NBA All-Star. And it reminds me a little bit of Stephen Ashworth, because every time Wally shot the ball, it looked like it was going in. And with that made free throw, Ashworth has made 53 of his last 55 free throws. Wally had that same type of form that every time he shot the ball, you were surprised if he ever missed.
Ashworth makes them both.
By the way, I didn't jinx Ashworth there. That does not exist when you start talking about how great a shooter is. That's phony.
I don't think that jinx works on elite shooters. Rodriguez on the drive, get some contact there.
Now, I actually thought that should have been a three-point play for Ashworth, and I would like to see that evolution in the college game of continuation. I think that makes the game more exciting when there's a continuation, just like that last play for Rodriguez. I thought that should have been a shooting foul.
Rodriguez. Way off balance on that shot. Hit the backboard first, then the rim. And we get another foul here against UNLV. And that'll be free throws. So that's team foul number 10, number 9, I beg your pardon.
This is what you don't want to do. Utah State is a squad 77% from the free throw line.
RJ Idle Rock will go to the line. Idle Rock at 75% from the stripe. Connects on the first. Again, another player that played for Coach Odom at UMBC. Was on the all-rookie team in the America East. Only one of the Utah State players. Talk about older players. He's already graduated. Degree in sociology. So Idle Rock rattles home that one. UNLV's got to find some scoring from their starting lineup. They've got 13 bench points of their 25. Harkless has 10. There's a drive and a miss. Offensive rebound and a near takeaway. And they say, we got a foul underneath. Shane Knoll.
I mean, how many layups has UNLV missed at point-blank range? I've counted at least six, and you can see Kevin Kruger, he's frustrated as well.
But do you think that there's been some more fouls down there in those missed layup attempts that have not been called?
At this point in the year, I like that the referee's going to let guys play. I didn't love that offensive foul call on Keyshawn Hall. His defender was inside the circle. He was playing with a physicality. But UNLV, you know, this time of year, you got to make bunnies, and they have missed a ton of them in this game. You know, you add in those 5-6 layups, all of a sudden, this game's much, much closer.
Ziamota, the first ever NCAA player from Bahrain, checking in.
This is right around the danger zone time, so they're going to get two more possessions here. It's such a mental edge if you can go into the half in single digits after trailing by double digits for the latter half of this first half.
Now the southpaw connects on the free throw. 13-point game here in Vegas. These two teams played a 4-point game in Logan. Shulga had Harkless all over him. Harkless commits the foul. UNLV now over the limit as Harkless picks up his second. And this will be two free throws here for Shulga, who's got a nice first half here with 12 points.
Now, I understand you want to pressure teams, and that's your identity, but that's a foul if you're E.J. Harkless, you go back.
I mean, you don't really need to guard Shulga that far away from the basket.
No, but that's what UNLV does, you know what I mean? Like, that's their identity, but if you're E.J. Harkless, you just have to be smarter, and you have to kind of know where that line is and not cross it defensively. He crossed it defensively. He put his hands on Shulga's back.
Shulga connects on the free throws. 14 points in the game for the junior from Kiev. UNLV coughs it up here. And we're going to get a foul called against Samoda. It'll be the first foul on Samoda.
Yeah, Harkless was really outstanding, out of this world in their win against Air Force. That was a game they trailed by one with under 10 seconds left, didn't have the ball. Got a steal, he had the game-winning tip-in, 23 points. He was the only UNLV player in double figures.
And what a month of February he had. He led the Mountain West in scoring in February at 23.3 points per contest. And he's kind of had to carry the load because of plenty of injuries on this UNLV team, and they really don't have that second true scoring option.
Yeah, it was Gilbert earlier in the year.
But a young player that stepping into a starting role was very good in the non-conference. Off. 42-29 now as we approach the 1 minute mark. Last 8 points for Utah State have come from the free throw line. Ashworth trying to change that. Bearstone gets up in the air, kind of got caught up in the air, gets it to Funk. Ashworth back out to the corner. Great defense in this possession. Amoda launches the three in and out. Rebound grabbed by UNLV, trying to get some points here. Get some momentum before we reach the intermission. Knoll, some fancy dribbling for a second, then dribbled it off the back of his ankles. And a turnover here for UNLV. Ashworth to Bearstone. Amoda drives baseline, takes it to the rim and scores. Z Amoda. That's his first bucket. Utah State firmly in control here in Las Vegas. They lead 44-29. Let's take a look at the Jeep AP Top 10. Right up at the top, the Cougars of Houston trying to get to the Final Four in their home city. See where they're at. Alabama, Kansas, UCLA, Purdue round out the top five. Thoughts on this top 10, Timmy?
Yeah, I think UCLA is going to end up being my pick. Mick Cronin has experience there. Jaime Jaquez has been there before. Tiger Campbell, you add in Amari Bailey. When he's healthy, he gives you that dynamic wing presence. When I handicap college basketball right now, continuity, experience, especially at the guard position, that's what's going to win in March.
How about the job that Shaka Smart's done at Marquette? Got him at number top five in the country. He has him kind of in the mix in a very, very tough Big East this year. And then the job that they've done at Texas after the Chris Beard situation. Just a tremendous tournament we have in store for us with some very good teams around college basketball. We'll wait and see to see how many teams out of the Mountain West get in this year. The conference tournament, which you can watch here on CBS and CBS Sports Network, is going to be tremendous. Webster, 10 on the shot clock here. Harkless thought about it. Here comes the double, lost both defenders, launches the three, and he got it. E.J. Harkless from downtown, his third three-pointer. 2 seconds to go. Bearstow on the other end, off of the glass, too strong. And UNLV gets the final bucket of the half.
And Ryan Odom had Utah State in his zone. They went 1-3-1. Watch this ball fake. It was a simple... The defense just ran away from me. He goes, oh, no problem with that. I know he's shooting sub 30% from three, but that guy is a walking bucket. You don't want to lose him on the offensive end. Utah State, though, fantastic in the first half on the road.
15 points for E.J. Harkless. He's certainly carried the load for the Rebels of UNLV. AT&T 5G at the half is next. Utah State up by 12 in this quad two game in Vegas. Vegas, the Rebels of UNLV in their final home game of the regular season, the penultimate game of the Mountain West regular season, the 44-32 lead for Utah State. As we welcome you back courtside, Alex DeMario alongside Tim Doyle. Glad to have you aboard here. Tim, Utah State took control about the midpoint of that first half, and UNLV just struggled to find some offense other than E.J. Harkless.
UNLV missed a few bunnies in this game, but let's give Utah State the credit they deserve. They were outstanding on the offensive end. Shot over 50% from the field. And one of the keys to this game was, can they compete with UNLV's physicality? Well, they have more second chance points, they've won the rebounding battle, and they have matched that physicality of UNLV. They were the tougher team in that first half, and I was not expecting that coming into the game. On the flip side, E.J. Harkless is carrying all of his weight. He has nearly half of the Running Rebels' points. They have 32 as a team, he has 15. Came into this game shooting sub 30% from three. He's made three threes. He's doing it all right now. You know what he's crying out for?
Certainly needs it right now. Let's take a look at the first half stats brought to you by Mountain Dew. Look at the rebounding end for Utah State. They're the second best defensive rebounding team in the Mountain West, and they're showing it right here as you can see what they're leading 22-14 overall.
And one story that's kept UNLV in this game, Utah State has turned the ball over 9 times. Came into this game, previous matchup, they had 21 turnovers. I think the first 5 minutes of the second half is going to dictate this game because UNLV ended that half on a little bit of momentum.
Yeah, they were able to get a bucket there at the very end. They were the last bucket of the half. They still trail by 12 here. All right, conversations in the locker room are what I like to ask as we get started in the second half, Tim Doyle. As we get a turnover right there, that's the 10th for Utah State. It's a little miscommunication right off the bat. What do you want to see from each of these teams coming out of the locker room?
Yeah, I want to see someone else other than Harkless get going. You know, whether it's Gilbert or Rodriguez, he needs some help on the offensive end.
There's a takeaway. There's a collision there. Harkless. Kind of a rough foul for him to take here this early in the second half. That's already his third.
And that was really the story in the first matchup. He only had 2 points in the game because he was in foul trouble the entire game.
And just 1 of 5 from the field in the game in Logan. And you can almost feel and sense in the early going that he was trying to do a lot because he didn't have that strong effort in that game. It was obviously his worst scoring output of the season as Utah State gets the first bucket of the second half here. Deshaun Gilbert. Love to get him going again. Gilbert drives, draws some contact, gets it to go. Tough shot right on cue. Gilbert able to put it home, plus the foul.
And that was the same exact play they ran, and they turned the ball over. So you can tell that Kevin Krueger at halftime had that drawn up, and he wanted to get someone else other than E.J. Harkless going. Great body control. And this kid was sensational to start off the year, almost like a triple-double type threat, and you could just tell is just not playing with that same confidence and swagger. Maybe that bucket gets him going.
He's kind of been up and down. He had a really good stretch in the early part of this month, a couple of 19-point efforts against Fresno State and against San Diego State. But he hasn't been the player that he was in the first 10 games of the season when they were 10-0. Finds some room, floats one up high off the glass, can't get it to go. And here comes UNLV the other way. They've got it to 11. Gilbert has it poked from behind, and we're going to get a foul here called against Utah State. And I believe this is on Ashworth. Beg your pardon, it's Funk, sorry.
Gilbert was just surrounded. Talk about triple coverage. I think he might have caught a break there with that foul.
So UNLV here trying to get it to single digits on this possession. Now we're going to inside. It's Mwaka. Haven't called his name much. Coming out of nowhere here is Gilbert with the second effort. Offensive rebound and a putback. And it's a 9-point game now. Like what you see from the Rebels here in the early going?
Just feels like they're going to make a run here, but that all starts on the defensive end. And right now, Utah State, when they're taking care of the ball, is getting great shots.
Unbelievable toss-up, and I don't know how Akin was able to finish that one. Take another look at this. Count the basket and the foul.
You got big bodies flying everywhere, and great job by the UMBC transfer to stick with that. Now a chance for a monster 3-point.
He didn't even really dunk that. He kind of tipped that one in and then and had his hand on the rim afterwards. That was an incredible effort there from Akin. As Mwaka was the one that committed the foul there, by the way, on the three-point play. Back to 12, Utah State leading.
And E.J. Harkless out of the game with those three fouls.
So Gilbert's going to be asked to get some points, drives it in, misses that time. Mwaka taps it, and they say last touch, Utah State. So take a look at the players in foul trouble here. Dorius with three for Utah State. You see Harkless on the bench with three. Gilbert, Hall, McCabe all with two for UNLV.
This has to be the Keyshawn Gilbert time right now for UNLV.
Drive here. Noel draws the foul here. Yeah, free throws coming up here for the Rebels. CBS Sports celebrates Women's History Month, recognizing the outstanding contributions women and girls have made on and off the field of play. Taylor Funk. Just kind of shocking to me. You haven't been able to get him going. He still does not have a bucket in this game. He's committed the second foul here. Utah has one of their key players in foul trouble. He's 0 for 1 from the field. He's only taken 1 3-point attempt. This is one of the best three-point shooters in the country, but he's 2 for his last 22 from three. Talk about being in a funk right now for Taylor. Miss on the free throw and a tap out here for UNLV.
Yeah, Johnson missed Gilbert. He was open in the corner there after that amazing save.
Johnson from way outside puts it in. Jackie Johnson, the sophomore from Wichita, the Duquesne transfer, puts that one in. Turnover number 11 for the Aggies.
Well, we set for UNLV to win this game. We needed 7-plus threes. They're trending towards that mark right now, and coaches don't want to hear this, but players play harder when they make shots on the defensive end. And that is a big possession here momentum-wise because this game is starting to turn towards UNLV.
Rebels down to 5 on the shot clock here. Doing some good things on the floor right now. 2 on the shot clock. Noel puts it up. Can't get it to go, but draws another foul. More free throws coming up here for UNLV. Foul is on Funk. That's number 3 for Funk.
Now if you're Kevin Kruger, now it's about managing E.J. Harkless on the bench. Right, I think the goal was to keep him out to maybe under the 16-minute mark, but now maybe you can stretch that to maybe the 13-minute mark in order to protect your star player who already has 3 fouls.
Miss on the first free throw here. RJ Heidelrock will come in.
Because where would they be without Harkless? He had 15 of the 32 points in the first half for UNLV, and now he's on the bench.
They had no other offense in that first half. Struggle with those layups that we talked about, and maybe it was physical, maybe it wasn't, and some of those bunnies that they missed. But nevertheless, they found themselves down double digits and really could not find any type of flow, couldn't find a three-point effort outside of Harkless, who's not a three-point shooter. They couldn't get McCabe three-point looks, who's an excellent three-point shooter.
This is an important possession here for Utah State. And pressure for UNLV. What this does is they just want Utah State to get into their offense a little bit later, and they are. Look at this. They're not in their offense yet. There's 18 on the shot clock.
Kevin Kruger wanted a backcourt violation there. Didn't look like there was a tap out into the backcourt. He was right in front of us. Idle Rock with 7 on the shot clock here. Lost the handle. Another turnover. Ball is loose in the front court. Able to grab it. There was Johnson. Active hands for the Rebels. 12 turnovers now. Three-pointer, got it! Jackie Rebels are red hot here in Vegas.
UNLV's making shots here, and they're clawing back into this game. It's late night in Sin City. You're watching College Basketball March to March, presented by Principal.
College Basketball on CBS Sports Network is sponsored by Werner, the official ladder of NCAA March Madness. Reach new heights by Mountain Dew, bold, refreshing citrus flavor. Do the Dew. And by Reese's Peanut Butter Cups.
It is senior night here in Las Vegas. The Aggies of Utah State, seeing their lead dwindling down, the Rebels have cut it to a four-point game here as E.J. Harkless among those honored here on senior night. But it's Jackie Johnson, the sophomore from Wichita, getting things done in the second half, especially from long range.
He shot five of them against Air Force. He only made one of them. He's been a difference maker here. It's three of three from three. Came into the game only 31% from three. He had a great start to the year where he was double figures in six of the first eight games, but you know, scouting reports get better. They know to crowd him, but he has found some space in this game, and he is shooting the ball with a ton of confidence.
He scored in double figures six times in the non-conference. Hasn't scored in double figures since. That could change tonight. He's got nine, which ties the most he's had since the San Diego game. Not San Diego State, but San Diego. So good effort. You're looking for someone else to score. Jackie Johnson's picked up a little bit of the slack here for the Rebels. Big possession here for Utah State. Ashworth buries the three. A dagger there from Ashworth. Stops the bleeding a bit scoring-wise for Utah State. They're back up by six.
Yeah, I think they're going to review him. Was his foot on the line? It looked like a two from my angle, but that was an enormous shot because Utah State didn't really have much going offensively.
So the scoreboard initially just put a two up there. They've since put an extra point to make it 52-45. But you think they're going to look at that as we get a whistle here?
I thought he stepped in the line, but I'm not a pro. It was a huge shot as Utah State clinging on to a must win.
Let's take a look at that three-point attempt, or what we thought was a three-point attempt from Stephen Ashworth. You can see his toe on the line. They did call it a two after reviewing it during the break. So it is a 51-45 game here. Pretty clear as day, Timmy.
Yeah, but that was a big-time shot. It was just a one-on-one. He was able to make a play.
Tomorrow night at 8 Eastern, catch some CUSA play as the Mean Green of North Texas aim for a solid closeout as they take on Middle Tennessee. That's a good CUSA matchup. Watch it all unfold right here on CBS Sports Network. Just take a look at Tyler Perry and what he's done in his career at North Texas. He leads the team in scoring at nearly 17 per game. Had a rough one his last time out against Charlotte, only 8 points in that game. That's a big one for North Texas as they are trying to build their tournament resume. Probably no chance at an at-large for North Texas, but FAU certainly at-large locked in now at a CUSA. North Texas, though, dangerous in that CUSA tournament going on in Frisco.
I'm going to be at that game tomorrow, live on the call. Excited to see Grant McCaslin and his squad. They certainly defend. Speaking of defense, another turnover by Utah State. If they lose this game, Ryan Odom's going to know exactly what to point to. He's saying right now, stop throwing the ball away.
Is that lip reading, or are you just assuming that? Hey, Walker. And turnover on this end. Utah State, pretty good defensive team themselves.
You know, Milwaukee's got to know better, because that's McCabe cutting.
Another big shot from the outside here for Utah State. A three-pointer there from Stephen Ashworth. Ashworth now with 19 points. Beg your pardon, 22 points now for the sharpshooter.
And now's the time, if I was Kevin Kruger, I'd get E.J. Harkless back in the game.
Here's McCabe just trying to find some room, and he turns it over. And McCabe, that's a guy. He's a guy who was a starter for every game last season that he played in for UNLV. He's turned into a role player for this, and it's kind of he kind of struggled to get into that role here. Utah State turns it over again. We got another substitution. Webster. Harkless still has not come into the game yet. You see him there on the bench.
Yeah, I think the last couple of possessions have been so poor for UNLV. I would go to your leading scorer right now. I get that he has three fouls. He's probably trying to wait to that under 12 timeout, but they have not gotten a good shot in a few possessions.
Johnson trying to work his head. That's a rough handle there on the pass there from Webster. UNLV turns it over again, struggling to hang on to the basketball these last couple of minutes. Bad pass there from Ashworth. Don't say that often from him. Ashworth launches from way outside from the hash mark. Launches another three. He's got 24, his fourth three-pointer. Timeout, Rebels. And the air has been taken out of the Thomas and Mack Center, 57-45. Let's see who's reaching new heights, brought to you by Werner Ladder. Well, Steven Ashworth. He's come on strong here. He's been great all season from downtown, but he's showing his versatility as well.
Well, this is what you want, right? It's March. Your team is desperate for a win. You can't have a slip up. UNLV has made a run. They've cut it to four. And what has Ashworth done? He's made every big shot down the stretch. Now you look at the lineup for UNLV, EJ Harkless. Back out there, I thought Kevin Kruger might have waited a possession or two too long to get a star player, 55 in white.
It's the sixth 20-point outing of the season for Ashworth. He's got 24 and counting for Utah State. A whistle here underneath. They wanted to travel. That's what Dan Akin is signaling down there, but a foul has been called, and Akin is like beside himself after that foul call as he picks up his third. No expression here from Ryan Odom.
Let's check this out again. This is what Hall does. He puts his head down. Now that's a shot he normally makes. You know what I love about Keyshawn Hall? He's shooting 50% from three. So he's more of kind of a bully ball type player. Lower that right shoulder, go strong to the hoop, but he's got a really soft touch. A 6'7 freshman from Cleveland. I have high hopes for him here in Vegas.
He's another guy that when we were here for shoot around, he was here early. Keyshawn Hall. Luis Rodriguez committing the foul here. Comes right back over to Utah State.
Well, Ashworth has just been remarkable in scoring the basketball in this game. Now, Harkless was guarding him earlier, but with the three fouls, it's going to be McCabe now.
And Ashworth has really picked it up and really has had no other help scoring-wise. Ashworth, ooh, I thought he was going to pull up from there. Ashworth lost his defender, tosses one up. Underneath, beautiful feed for Dorius, who has a couple of nice finishes in this game. 59-46. And boy, the energy has really been taken out of the Thomas and Mack. Webster, runner. No. And these are turning into one-shot possessions here. Turnover, traveling violation on the slip here from Ashworth.
Well, that seems to be the only thing that could stop him. There's a wet floor, and watch out, Ashworth is like, okay, what's the defense gonna give me? Okay, they're gonna give me a little bit of edge here. Wait, our 7-1 guy gets switched by a 6-1 guy? Why don't I just lob it to him? And now, whoop. I don't know if there was maybe a little Captain Morgan on the floor there, but he goes slipping and falling, and there's another turnover.
Harkless bosses defender once. Shulga still on him. Misses the pull up there, fall away. And now here come Bairstow on the fast break. Throws it up, can't get it to go, but a foul is called. And it's going to be, I believe, against Rodriguez. That's the third foul on Rodriguez. It's already five team fouls on UNLV.
there's still a ton of time in this game, but what Kevin Kuerger told us today was when the ball moves, when they're moving side to side in the last handful of possessions for UNLV, right? It's been a lot of one-on-one. You see the great Lon Kruger there. He's one of the all-time great basketball players at Kansas State and then coached multiple stops along the way, coached in the NBA as well. And his son in his second year has done a nice job of building the program.
He was inducted in the College Basketball Hall of Fame earlier in the season, back in November.
What a career Lon Kruger had, and now he's just being a grandpa.
That's why he looks relaxed over there.
He always looked relaxed.
That's just Lon Kruger.
You see the standing around? It's just one-on-one ball, and that's where they get into trouble. Right? Other guys got to be moving on the offensive end.
It was an 8-0 run for UNLV to close the gap. Since then, it's been a 12-1 run by Utah State, and Shulga takes it to the bucket, making a 14-1 run now for Utah State over the last 4 minutes and change. UNLV needs a bucket in a bad way. Rodriguez, off-balance shot, draws the contact. They say no shot, though. 63-46 our score. UNLV hanging on. Utah State starting to pull away. It's been a 14-1 run for Utah State. They lead it 63-46 against UNLV. Max Shulga making things happen. The subject of tonight's Reese's player profile. He gets the bucket to go there. Shulga already in this game with 16 points. 25 career games scoring in double figures. It's 19 this season from Ukraine. Fluent in Ukrainian, Russian, English, and Spanish. Big part of what Utah State is doing this year.
He is the ultimate glue guy for Ryan Odom. Four double-doubles on the year, and it's been all Utah State here. Now, if you're UNLV, gotta keep moving offensively. Guys have been standing around on offense.
Keyshawn Hall with some strength. Works inside and draws another foul.
Hall's going to the free throw line.
Now, Hall could be one of the better players in this league. I think his biggest thing is going to be his body and his offseason conditioning. He's got good length. Put the ball on the floor. He's got soft touch. Now it's about eating right, working out, and working on your game.
That's the same conversation you had with me yesterday.
Yeah, and staying off the strip. Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Except for the working on my game part. That part's way over. Shulga. Akin finds a seat, takes it to the hoop strong, and finishes off of the window there. 65-48, Utah State well in control now. 16-3-1. As we get a miss here from Gilbert that draws another foul. Fouls are becoming an issue now for Utah State as Akin commits his fourth. So now they're bigs. Akin and Dorius both have four fouls.
Free throw good there from Gilbert. A.J. Harkless has been scoreless the first 9-plus minutes here in the second half. He had 15 at halftime. Picked up his third foul pretty early in the half and still has 15.
Akin going to the bench. Taylor Funk back in. He's got three fouls. Funk, we've talked about the struggles he's had lately in terms of shooting the three. He's an excellent three-point shooter at 37% on the year, but two for his last 22 from downtown. 0-for-1, that's the only shot he's attempted tonight. Funk has really struggled as of late, especially tonight, as Ashworth misses from downtown. Shulga
tracks down the rebound, and a fresh 20 here for the Aggies. Shulga.
Nice dump off and a slam there from Amoda.
That's going to be an easy technical foul. It was actually two technicals in one, which I guess if you're going to get your money's worth, here's the two technicals. First of all, let's not overshadow the play. It's a great pass here by Shulga. Gets up in the air and then finds Moda. But here's the first technical. He pulls himself up. There's one. And then there's the second slap in the backboard. Amazing. He got his money's worth on that technical. Because you can't slap the backboard and you can't pull yourself up. And he goes, you want to know something? I'm going to do both of those because I just had an awesome dunk on CBS.
How much of that is it he knew that he already got one technical? He's like, ah, well, I'm up here. let me just get this mosquito that's right there.
Yeah.
17-point lead for Utah State.
Harkless not trying to get the pass, and Ashworth had that one sniffed out. Shulga in the open floor, now retreats back out. Bairstow, baseline, lost some room. Funk, Ashworth, Bairstow in the corner. Got it. Sean Bairstow from downtown, he shoots it from 43% from out there. Timeout Rebels. Bairstow now 7 points for him to go along with 10 rebounds.
Yeah, if you looked up ball movement in the dictionary, this play may show up because Funk had an open look, Ashworth had an open look, and instead Bairstow gets a perfect look in the corner. He buries the three. The bench is pumped. What do they have, like members from NSYNC on the bench there? That's amazing. It was like 5-5-5.
It's like they have a whole routine, you know? It's like the NFL where they have those touchdown dances as a team. So we take a look at Utah State's tournament resume. We talked about this game being a quad two game, very important because right now Jerry Palm has them in their in his next four out. So they need to make up some ground. They got a chance here with a quad two game. They'll finish the season with Boise. That's a quad one game for them. And of course, the Mountain West tournament.
Well, they have responded in this game because the wheels were coming off. This was a game they led by double digits at halftime that got down to four. And then Stephen Ashworth just made some big-time clutch shots.
21-5 run here over the last 6.5 minutes for Utah State. Harkless lost his defender, launches the three. It's kind of a heat check for him. Harkless 3 of 4 from downtown in this game. He's scoreless here in the second half. All 15 of his points came in the first. He's been in foul trouble here in the second half, which was the story the last time these two teams met. Funk didn't take the three, takes it to the rim, a little finger roll action. You just got to see the ball go through the hoop if you're a shooter and you're struggling.
He's done a good job of not pressing either in this game. He's made the extra pass. He's continued to play the right way. And for UNLV, man, they were playing so well to start the half. And then the wheels just came off as whoever had the ball, everyone just started watching them go one-on-one.
Funk to Ashworth, back to Funk. From way outside, takes the three off the back of the rim. 2 for his last 23 from downtown. Harkless, strong move, trying to draw some contact, has it blocked. Shulga, the other way, trying to dish it off for Funk. The pass was behind him, they turn it over. That's 16 turnovers here for Utah State. And when they run this film back tomorrow here, Tim Doyle, doesn't matter what the outcome is going to be, he's going to look at those turnovers.
Yeah, I mean, second half for the Aggies, they're 11 of 15 from the field, 73%.
Rodriguez. This is short. Skip it to McCain, lost his defender with a ball fake. 3-point attempt, McCain misses it in and out. And rebound, and it's gonna be a foul that's gonna keep it on this end of the floor. We're in Las Vegas, Utah State, trying to finish off a quad two win. You're watching March to March, presented by Principal. take a look at your keys to the game again, Tim Doyle?
Well, they have not taken care of the ball at Utah State, but when you shoot 73% in the second half, who cares about that? They've won the rebounding battle, and that's been big. Heartless was hot, not so much in the second half, and the three. 4-point game, the crowd was into it, and then all of a sudden, this run Utah State has been on has just opened up this lead, and for Ryan Odom, we loved his transparency at shoot-around. He said, we talk about it. We're on the bubble. We let everybody know that every game matters to us, and this experienced squad has responded here in the second half.
Well, that's the key right there that I thought was very important that you laid out earlier, that the fact that he is transparent with his team, but that he can do that because he has a veteran team. Maybe if he had a team full of freshmen and sophomores that happened to be on the bubble, it might be a different story.
Well, you got to be like a father figure, right? You got to protect them. It's like after a show that sometimes you're not that great in, I go, you were outstanding, because I want to build your confidence. I want to tell you, move in the right direction. You're not even listening to me.
Last field goal for UNLV came at the 15:56 mark. It's been a struggle for the Rebels offensively throughout the game, but especially after that run, they got it to four. Nice pass, Bearstone. Ball movement is just tremendous for this Utah State team. Ashworth gets it back. Bounce pass. Oh, what a play! Two-handed flush. Trevin Dorius with the jam. The lead is 22 now for Utah State. Johnson, a little hezzy, lost his dribble now. Out to McCabe with 8 seconds of the shot clock. McCabe thought about launching, gets it to Waco, misses, has it blocked. In transition, Hamoda to the rim with the jam. No tee that time from Hamoda. Gabe getting some room, launches the three, in and out that time. Dorius with a rebound. Green transition, Ashworth. Well, plenty of contact there, but they're going to give a block, I guess, or a steal. Here to McCabe. Out of the open floor. Now it's McCabe, right wing for three. Misses short again. Man, has he been cold tonight. Jordan McCabe now 1-for-4 from downtown.
Ashworth is just picked apart UNLV. Whatever the defense has given them, he has exploited it. On the other end, Hamoda dunked with two hands and picked up the technical. He said one hand this time. He looks at the bench, he smiles. Great athleticism there. And the 6'7 sophomore, I think he's going to be a really effective player off the bench next year. And then as a senior, I could see him as a double-digit scorer.
His minutes have kind of gone down in Mountain West play, but he's certainly a big part of what they're going to be doing in the future. Hamoda, the first ever NCAA player from Bahrain. Bounce backs down low. Foul drawn here. Carl Jones getting an opportunity here, the junior from Chicago. As we look at the Mountain West Conference standings, you see UNLV three back in the win column of San Diego State, two back in the loss column. But you see 1 through 8. You can even throw Air Force and Colorado State in the mix. Wyoming getting healthy at the right time. I'll tell you what, Tim, there's some dangerous teams in the bottom part of the standings there for the Mountain West come tournament time next week.
Oh, no doubt about it. It's going to be a really fun Mountain West tournament here in Vegas. They actually switch out the court here for the conference tournament. Were you surprised to hear that?
We were having that conversation during shoot-around about, well, do the guys get excited about getting to play the conference tournament here? Well, they change the seating arrangement. It's a different floor, the configuration. They don't get to use their locker room. So it's as close to a neutral environment as they could possibly try to make it. The only real benefit is that they get to sleep in their own beds.
This was a bounce back effort because last out Utah State only mustered up 65 points against Wyoming, shot 26% from three. They had more turnovers than assists.
they really responded against an excellent defensive team in UNLV.
Yeah, they had those two games at the start of February against San Diego State and San Jose State as Harkless takes it to the rim and scores. Losing those games close. They've had some close losses. Utah State lost a lot more of those close games last year. There were seven games last year Utah State lost that were by two or fewer points. And that was Coach Odom kind of telling us this team had to grow up and learn how to win those games. Those games they're winning this year.
And those seven losses by two or fewer points. Now listen to this, folks. We got the highlights of those losses. And while the team was lifting weights, Dorius goes to the bench. He fouls out with five fouls. But as his team was working out in the offseason, he would put on the monitors in the weight room.
The close losses.
The losses.
I mean, that, and you were like, this torture.
Yeah, that is like a tough loss right there. I don't think you can get away with that now. But he used it as motivation.
Drive to the bucket there. Score, Shane Knoll, the sophomore. Utah State going to be a dangerous out in the conference tournament, but they certainly not. They got to keep improving their resume if they want to get in. As Isle Rock takes it to the rim, goes reverse on the layup there. Gilbert. Off to Harkless, swinging around Johnson, thought about the three. He was hot earlier from downtown. He was the one to hit the shot that got it to four. Harkless got the three, another three-pointer from E.J. Harkless. That's his fourth from downtown. Not used to seeing E.J. Harkless make that many threes. He did have five in the game against Wyoming. That was his season high. In transition, trying to get it to Harkless. Too far a pass, and Johnson upset. He committed the turnover there.
And Ryan Odom has a plethora of guys that can go out there and make plays. RJ Adirock followed him from UMBC. It's been a good move so far.
Coming up next, we'll take it coast to coast for the latest hardwood news and insights as the road to the Final Four continues. Adam Zucker, Wally Zerbiak, Gary Parrish, Renee Montgomery, all in studio in New York. Don't miss Inside Catholic Basketball right here on CBS Sports Network. As we take a look at what the Utah State Aggies have done tonight, we always talk about their three-point shooting, but it's points in the paint. It's been a strength tonight, outscoring UNLV 38-20 in that department.
Yeah, well, they came into the game leading the Mountain West, shooting 40% three, and UNLV has done a great job of getting out and guarding shooters. Now, on the flip side, Utah State is taking advantage of that. They have shot 74% here in the second half. And they have done a great job, Ryan Odom's crew, of getting in the lane and converting, not just settling for deep ones. This was a four-point game in the second half, and then a 21-5 run opened it up.
Shooting 41% from three tonight. They're 14-1 this season when they shoot 36% or better from downtown. But a complete team is Ashford. What a pass down there, getting it to Dan Akin. Kind of been that kind of game for UNLV, especially in the second half. Lead is 20 for the Aggies. Another takeaway here for Utah State.
And after Ryan Odom, you're gonna wonder when you get your stars out of the game, because you're up 20 right now, you wouldn't want anyone to get hurt.
This from Idle Rock. Now, what a season it's been on the women's basketball side for the Rebels. Look at the celebration. An 18-0 regular season in the Mountain West. You see the celebration in the locker room here against Nevada. The women have just been tremendous over these last two seasons as Taylor Funk commits his fifth foul. And they are going to be a dangerous team come the NCAA tournament.
And you got a chance to see them live earlier in the year.
They are tremendous, and they have been getting tremendous fan support here in Las Vegas. So much fan support that you see Becky Hammon come in and check in on the UNLV Rebels team. But Lindy LaRocque has just done an excellent job with the Rebels team here. And you see Coach Kevin Kruger in his second season trying to get his team to that level, something that his dad Lon was able to do here. Chad in the audience tonight, watching some of this. Ashworth launches from long range, rattles that one in. Another big three. Lady Rebels currently 22 in the country. Miss inside. 63-62 our score. Let's take a look at the bracket for the Mountain West Conference Tournament if it started today. And this is assuming a victory for Utah State. They'd be the 4 seed taking on San Jose State, who has been excellent with Tim Miles running the show there. San Diego State, Boise State, and Nevada, the other top seeds in the Mountain West.
You got a pick? Because I do.
I still have to take Boise.
I like New Mexico. They got off to a great start, got in top 25. You got experience in guard play in Mashburn and House. That's going to be my sleeper pick.
That's your sleeper pick. What's your pick? Now in the corner, three-point attempt, Ziamota. Oh, a coming out party for him as he hits from downtown. He's got 9. We're going to take away here, Utah State. Right now, Jerry Palm has, oh, what a throwdown! Dan Akin with a rim rocker. Akin just having some fun now. Tim, this looks like an NCAA tournament team. Right now, they're on the last, or this, pardon me, the next 4 out, according to Jerry Palm. But this is a resume booster for them, picking up this win here in Vegas.
This is a quad 2 win for Utah State. This will make them now 6-1. 4 straight wins for Ryan Odom's group. And this was a commanding win. The nice thing in conference is there's still opportunities to get quad 1 wins with the depth of this Mountain West Conference.
The Idle Rock up top. Shulga launches. Got it. Utah State 30 in the net as we get a whistle for some substitution. All right, so let's take a look at who Jerry Palm has as the first 4 out, meaning these are the teams that just don't quite get in. All for Power 5 conferences, Oklahoma State, Penn State, UNC, which was once right at the top of the country. And then you got 2 Mountain West clubs as the next 4 out. New Mexico, who you just talked about, is a team that could win the Mountain West tournament, and this Utah State team. And you got Clemson and Oregon. The biggest problem for Utah State, they have no quad 1 wins. They are 0-4 in their quad 1 opportunities. They will have a chance at a quad 1 when they take on Boise State to finish the season. 3-pointer. Johnson misses. Goal with the offensive rebound. Draws the foul. Once again, we'll take a look at the updated Mountain West Conference standings. The win puts Utah State at 12-5. That's 2 games back of San Diego State in the standings. 1 game behind Boise State for 2nd. Again, those 2 teams will square off coming up in the final game of the regular season coming up on Saturday. That game will be in Logan. You and I have both been to the Spectrum in Logan. It's a tough place for any team to get a victory.
Yeah, they only lost 2 home games this year. They lost to Weber State, a game that they led by double digits at halftime and ended up losing. You wonder if that loss is going to come back to bite them. And then they lost one of the best college games of the year to San Diego State at home. And you know it's going to be an electric environment in a game that means so much to Utah State.
And that fan base loves coming out for that matchup. I've called the Boise State-Utah State matchup in Logan, and that place can get loud. Johnson went for the Euro step and a runner, couldn't get it to go. Shot clock is off, and we get a foul here. The teams have gone to their benches here. That foul is on Connor Odom. And 2/10 seconds to go here in Vegas. Cameron burst at the free throw line here. Senior from right here in Las Vegas. It's Utah State team. I don't know, Tim, I think they deserve to be in the NCAA tournament.
And the nice part is the still got games to play, high quality games. You know, you knock off Boise, you make a run to the Mountain West Championship game. There's going to be some other quality wins along the way. So it's an invitational tournament. You got to earn the right to be invited. A dominant second half performance for Utah State and Ryan Odom. Four straight wins and a big one coming up this weekend.
23rd victory for the Aggies of Utah State. Their 12th win in the Mountain West Conference as they knock off UNLV 91-66. For Tim Doyle and our entire crew, my name is Alex Sobario. This has been a presentation of CBS Sports Network, the 24-hour home of CBS Sports. We'll send you back to our New York studio. Join Adam Zucker and the gang for Inside College Basketball.